Sunday, and we're going to be celebrating by using several languages throughout the service. Appreciate Cynthia using Dutch there to start the singing, and you also got a chance to see our Wednesday night children and youth, and great the technology can help us become one church even when we're in many different places and sections, even in our building. So that was cool and special, and we're excited to worship that way today. We're going to be joined by billions of other Christians this morning as we share together in the sacrament of Holy Communion. We're also excited this morning to be lifting up and welcoming you to worship here. If you're joining us on Facebook Live, we're grateful you're there that way. For those of you who are in person, we're delighted you're here. We invite you to fill out your attendance card to be able to acknowledge that you're here, and later when the acolytes, folks, acolytes, it's kind of cool to have a couple of our young men joining us again, serving in that way. Give the offering plates to the ushers, and they pass those. You'll be able to place that connect card there. We love to hear the prayer concerns that you have. We also want to hear the joys that you have. We call those glorious sightings. We lift it up when we see God at work in many lives today. We have had a busy week. Really appreciate those who were here on Friday to welcome our guests and neighbors who came for the community outreach day. And we had several hundred folks who came looking for help and services. We were able to connect with those in our community, and appreciate those of you who provided hospitality and made that possible for that event to run smooth. We are going to have a special event next Sunday morning for all of us to participate in. Between 9:30 and 11, we're going to have a reception for Brian Lamb, who has faithfully served us for 15 years here at the church. We don't often think about the people who mop the floors and prepare the sanctuary and clean the toilets and bathrooms and do all of those things. But Brian has faithfully served us in that way for the past 15 years. He's retiring, and we are going to celebrate him, and he'll be there for you to share your thanks and praise with him and with his wife Judy as they turn the page for a new chapter in his life. And we just want to celebrate and give you a chance to say thanks. So that'll be there. If you can't be there and you want to send a card, please do so through the office. We'll see that he gets it. It's one of those moments we get to do that for others. This week, there'll be Fields of Faith on Wednesday evening. A lot of those young people you saw there and many others will be going over to the junior high football field. It's one of those times when we see the body of Christ in Poplar Bluff come together as the youth groups from all over the area and surrounding communities come in, several thousand youth praising Jesus, singing songs. Adults are allowed to look in, and it is a heartwarming experience if you get a chance to do that sometime, to see that event. So having said all of that, we're excited and ready for worship, and we invite the choir to lead us now as they provide us with our choral introit this morning.
Seigneur Jésus-Christ soit avec vous.
Rich is fast. This is Linda Adams, who spoke that beautifully in French, and now, as you you are able, please stand for our call to worship. In English. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
The risen Christ is with us.
Praise the Lord.
Remain standing for our opening hymn.
Le Christ ressuscité est avec nous.
Well, to continue in the vein of world worship this morning before communion, we're going to sing our opening hymn of praise, number 64, Holy, Holy, Holy. But the choir will sing it in Spanish first. So we'll do choir in Spanish, and then you come in, first verse and the last verse. Hang on to your seats. We're going to worship the Lord in all these languages.
Scripture reading is Luke chapter 14, verse 25 to 33 in Korean. 곧 한 무리가 함께 갈세 예수께서 돌이켜사 이르시되 물은 내게 오는 자가 자기 부모와 처자와 형제와 자매와 및 자기 목숨을까지 바치지 아니하면 능히 나의 제자가 되지 못하고 누구든지 자기 십자가를 지고 나를 쫓지 아니하는 자는 나의 제자가 되지 못하리라. 너희 중에 누가 망대를 세우고자 할 때 자기의 가진 것이 출공하기까지 족할는지 먼저 앉아 그 비용을 계산하지 아니하겠느냐. 그렇지 아니하도 그 귀초만 쌓고 능히 이루지 못하면 보는 자와 다 빈속 가로되 이 사람이 역사를 시작하고 능히 이루지 못하였다 하리라. 또 어느 임금이 다른 임금과 싸우러 갈 때 먼저 앉아 일만으로 조의만을 가지고 오는 자를 대적할 수 있을까 헤아리지 아니하겠느냐. 만일 못할 터이면 자기 아직 조가 아직 멀리 있을 동안에 사실을 버려 화친을 종할지니라. 이와 같이 너희 중에 누구든지 자기의 모든 선을 버리지 아니하면 너희 내 제자가 되지 못하리라.
The word of God is certainly beautiful in any language. Large crowds were traveling with Jesus, and turning to them, he said, "If anyone comes to me and does not hate his father and mother, his wife and children, his brothers and sisters, yes, even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. And anyone who does not carry his cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. Suppose one of you wants to build a tower. Will he not first sit down and estimate the cost to see if he has enough money to complete it? For if he lays the foundation and is not able to finish it, everyone who sees it will ridicule him, saying, 'This fellow began to build and was not able to finish.' Or suppose a king is about to go to war against another king. Will he not first sit down and consider whether he is able with 10,000 men to oppose the one coming against him with 20,000? If he is not able, he will send a delegation while the other is still a long way off and will ask for terms of peace. In the same way, any of you who does not give up everything he has cannot be my disciple." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
We appreciate all of the extra efforts that have gone into providing the beautiful service today to connect us. The idea that we are not just the body of Christ here in Poplar Bluff, but we are all over the world. And one of the things that I would lift up for many of us who have friends or family or others that were in or close to the path of the hurricane, or for those who have seen the devastation that was caused by it. One of the great parts about being part of a connectional church is we already have folks on the ground assessing damages, working with people, because we have churches in those areas and pastors and congregations like you who are doing that, and the requests are coming. So if you want to give to hurricane relief and know that 100% of what you give gets to the people who need it, just make note of that. We'll be taking special offerings over the next couple of weeks, but if you want to do that today, just note that it's for hurricane relief, and we will send it through UMCOR, and 100% of what you give will go to the people in need, because we take care of all of the other administrative costs through our apportionments and other things that we do as local churches. So that's one of the beauties of being connected and being a part of a larger body. You'll also notice that your bulletin was a thing about Women Uniting and Our Ladies. October is their month, and they've been wrestling with the future for what the ladies groups are going to do and how they're going to do things. And one of the items that's been on the agenda is what to do with the two large sales that they've traditionally done over the last many years as a part of their fundraising kind of stuff. And as they were debating the possibility of not doing those, several of us were thinking in the back of our minds, well, what are we going to do with all of our junk that we don't want? And unfortunately, that's the way that a lot of folks Think about their faith. I will follow Jesus when I have a little extra time. If it doesn't get in the way of family that's in from out of town, or with the travel baseball season, or with any of the other things that are important in my life. And I'll give when I have a little left over. And I'll help the ladies with the stuff I don't want, and most people wouldn't want. So folks, over the next couple of weeks, we're going to start a series of sermons in which we're going to talk about the very uncomfortable biblical truth that we have taken Jesus' words and we make them fit our lifestyle, our values, our political views. We make Jesus fit us. Instead of hearing his words as a call to radical kingdom living discipleship in following Jesus. Now, I think part of that just comes from the fact that it's been really, really easy for most of us. We've either grown up in church, grown up around church, and we know when it gets to be political season that everybody claims to be a part of a church who's running for office. It's easy. But I want us to wrestle with the words of Jesus. Tim, actually, for the contemporary service, made it real talks with Jesus. I don't know what words you want to use, but when we really hear the words of Jesus, I want us to wrestle with the real meaning of what's going on. You see, in this very familiar scripture passage from Luke 14, there's something there for us to wrestle with. Jesus said, "Whoever comes to me and does not hate father, mother, wife, children, brothers, sisters, yes, even life itself cannot be my disciple." And I'm sure many of you have that thought in the back of your mind. I'm thinking, come on, Jesus is a family values guy, right? I mean, isn't the Bible all about family? We even have ministries that are named focused on the family and family value kinds of stuff. And we have people who make scores of money talking about relationships and different things within. What is Jesus talking about here? And so we either ignore it and think there may be a translation problem or something that can't really mean what it means. Or we make it fit somehow. But folks, I want you to hear it in context with the other two portions of Scripture. You know, part of our challenge is that we isolate these. And when you isolate these pieces of Scripture, you know, the second half of this, which of you building a tower does not first sit down and estimate the cost and see if you have enough to complete it? I mean, that sounds like good, sound financial advice. Otherwise, when he's laid the foundation, you're not able to finish it. You get ridiculed. I mean, we've even had stewardship sermons and campaigns, and there was a campaign in this church many, many years ago that was entitled Counting the Cost. And we see that and can hear that in those terms. It's real easy for us to wrap our mind around that. Now, we don't quite understand the king and war stuff because that's hard. But what I think is going on here is Jesus is using the bottom two to help illustrate the first, and we need to get back into what it was like to be a real disciple of Jesus. You see, what I think Jesus is calling the people who are coming to him to, it is what we today would call a burn your boats radical discipleship. And for, if you don't get that reference to burn your boats, that has to do with Cortez when he was invading Mexico and his Spanish Armada landed there, and as the soldiers got off, he instructed them to burn the boats to illustrate the fact that they were taking the Aztecs and there was no going back to Spain. They were burning the boats. And today in leadership circles, they talk about that in companies and in organizations that understand and realize that their technology or the way in which they're doing things no longer works in the world in which we live today. And when they make that paradigm shift, they talk about burning the boats. We stop doing the old and we start doing the new, and we burn the boats. Well, folks, we forget that there wasn't Christianity. The people who followed Jesus weren't raised in the church. They were coming out of either Judaism or some other pagan religion. And I don't imply Judaism as a pagan religion, just... And they were following Jesus in this new way of thinking and doing things. And for many of them, it really did mean leaving behind everything. When we see the disciples being called by Jesus, they leave their nets and their boats. They leave their livelihood. And I know many who are in my Bible class are thinking back to the calling of Elisha. And when Elisha was called by Elijah, he went back. He had been plowing the field and he asked Elijah, "Can I do one thing?" And what he went back to do is that he made a sacrifice of the oxen that pulled the plow, and he used the plow to burn the oxen to make the sacrifice, illustrating that he wasn't going back to his old life. And Jesus is saying, if you follow me, your family's not going to understand. And folks, a lot of times when we make radical life change, the people who love us and who we count on don't always understand. One of my first jobs was as a chaplain for Arizona Boys Ranch, one of those places fairly similar to Sears Youth Center here. It was a place where young men could choose to go instead of going to adult prison as teenagers. And there they had a very structured program and they learned a new way of living. Most of them had been in trouble for a long time, and their friends and family and others who were around them had drugged them into a life that took them down a dark path and they didn't know the difference. And what we discovered is most of them were followers. And so we had to teach them right from wrong and a new way of doing things. And as they were emerging and graduating, a part of my job was to evaluate the system they would go back into. And for many of them, that system was so toxic they couldn't go back home, because their family was why they were in trouble in the first place. And so in order to lead their new life, we had to develop a new system. Sometimes it was foster care. Sometimes it was they were old enough to be emancipated, but we created a community around them so that they would have structure to continue living their new life. Sometimes our hurts and habits and hang-ups come from those in our past. Not always. Folks, the people who were hearing this didn't have the advantage that many of you have, of having grown up in a loving family, a Christ-centered family, and mothers and fathers who would be supportive of you if you made a decision to do something about following Jesus. But understand, not everybody is supportive. And Jesus was telling them, when you follow me, count the cost. Because if you really follow me, it means reorienting your life in a whole different way. Because if you're going to carry my cross, your hands are going to be tied up and you can't hang on to all of those old possessions and those old ways of doing things. And I'm going to call you to love people radically and to give all that you have. Now, folks, it's real easy for some folks like me to say, oh, I've done this, I've lived into this. But I'm actually wrestling with this particular saying for the next phase in life. You know, what is retirement for a pastor? When you dedicated your whole life to Jesus and to serving Jesus, I don't see anywhere in Scripture it says we retire from being a disciple and from following Jesus, from being all in on Jesus. But when I stop getting paid to do this, when this is no longer my job, am I going to be mentoring other people? Am I going to do like some of the others and serve a small church, self-funding, so that they don't have to pay me? What is that next step? You see, all of us need to be wrestling with what is it to be all in? And what does it mean to be fully devoted to following Jesus? I love the symbol of what's going to happen here in a few minutes when you come to communion. We invite you to come and to kneel and to extend your hands in order to receive the bread and the juice, the body and blood of Christ. With your hands wide open, hopefully your heart is wide open, the other side of it is you're not hanging on to all of that old stuff. Whether it's hurts or habits or hang-ups that you need to get rid of and you need to let go of, that you're out with hands and hearts that are open to receive Jesus fully. But the question is, are you willing to receive Jesus fully? Are you going to say, Jesus, I give it all, but I'm hanging on to this? I hope and I pray that all of us are burn your boats all in on Jesus. As our invitation to the sacrament, I invite you to turn with me to page 7 in your hymnal as we share together. We'll hear the invitation, we'll pray together the prayer of confession and pardon. There'll be a time of silent prayer in the middle of that as well. But folks, on this Sunday, of all Sundays, we gather with our brothers and sisters around the world. We hear this invitation. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and before one another. Join me now in the prayer of confession and pardon. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We failed to be an obedient church. We've not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We've not loved our neighbors, and we've not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let's continue to pray in silence. hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love towards us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
And glory to God. Amen. Well, folks, as forgiven and reconciled people, let us offer ourselves and our gifts to God as we invite the acolytes to come and the ushers to receive the morning tithes and offering. Please turn to the Great Thanksgiving on page 9. moments, you'll be invited to come. Participate fully in the sacrament. This is God's table. We see this as God's table, and all are welcome. You'll be invited to kneel as long as you would like at the altar. And when you are ready to extend your hands, you receive the bread, the juice. So now let us prepare to bless this by joining together in the great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right to do good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image to breathe into us the breath of life. We turned away and our love failed. Your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, 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 holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
On the night in which he gave himself up for us, Jesus took bread, blessed it, broke it, and he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you." After supper, he took the cup, poured it, gave it to them. He said, "Drink you all of this, for this is my blood, the new covenant of grace, poured out for you and for everyone for the forgiveness of sin. Drink this in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of these mighty acts of Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ, offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ is God. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on us together here and on these gifts of bread and juice. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast in his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. If you will now, join with me in praying the traditional version of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. We who are many come to the one table to join in the one body, the body of Christ, broken for you and for me. And we come to share the one cup, the cup of God's grace, God's love poured out for you, for me, the forgiveness of sin. These are the gifts of God. People of God.
Thank you.
listening to the sermon, it occurred to me, God is telling me, Pam, you stay in your lane too often. You just get comfortable in whatever lane you're in. If the traffic in front of you slows down, you slow down. If it goes faster, you go faster. If it stops, you stop. When sometimes God's telling us to get in the other lane, God is telling us, he's flashing his headlights, come on over. But we're just staying in the same lane because we're comfortable. And I think Jesus wants more from us. Sometimes the traffic in front of you is what's keeping you from truly having a close relationship to Jesus. Our church is so blessed with just so many people. You heard Dutch from Cynthia Gonzalez. I had to write it down. You heard French from Linda Adams. You heard Korean from David Chung. You heard Spanish from the choir. All of those things, well, for the choir, I know they got out of their lane trying to do Spanish. But we had two young men today who got out of this lane and they tried something different for the first time. And that is Luke and Tyler, who were our acolytes. Can we just encourage them? That's what being one body in Christ is all about. The bread we sing about in One Bread, One Body is Jesus Christ. Let's stand and sing all verses of One Bread, One Body, hymn 620.
Thank you.
folks, we celebrate today that we are one body, the body of Christ. And as we go today, I invite you to go forth in peace. That the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit is with us all. Amen.